Hey, Internet. Gordon Ung with PC World here, and we have a special treat for you. I have Dell's Travis North, who is, official title, thermal technologist in the CTO's office. Basically, that means he's a thermal engineer and a thermal nerd. And the reason we want to talk to Travis today is because he works on laptops. And laptops, as you know, the more cooling you have, the better performance. And a lot of it's just sort of this mystery box. You don't know what's inside. For Travis, I want to ask you about the precision laptops that you guys have, because it has this feature. It's also in the XPS, but it's the DOO. It's the dual opposite outlet fan, which apparently cools in both directions. I initially thought it would sort of reverse flow and blow if the bottom was a block, but that's not it.
No, that's not it. The DOO is a Dell innovation where we're really taking the base physics of the fan and we're taking advantage of that. What makes the fan unique is the fact that the impeller size, so if you talk about the size of literally the wheel, dictates how much airflow, CFM, that you get, as well as how hard that airflow is pushed through the box. If you look at a traditional fan, most of the blowers that everybody uses today, the size of the impeller is about 70% of the overall housing. So the space that you have is limited. We started investigating this. We had a crack team within Dell that went in, and basically by looking at the impeller itself, the airflow through the internal housing of the fan, we realized that we could potentially get 30% more flow by growing the impeller. Now, here's the challenge. There's a limit. As you grow that impeller, basically the velocity increases and you have something that resists that airflow. It's called frictional losses. And so what happens in a traditional blower, air comes in from the hub side into the impeller. It turns 90 degrees and it's pushed out by the rotation of the blade. It creates a region of high pressure and low pressure. Low pressure pulls it in and pushes it out. What the DOO does, it pulls that same air in, it pushes out in two directions. That's why we call it dual opposite outlet. We are pushing out through the fin stack, the heat sink within the system, but we're also channeling the secondary path to push air into the system. And what happens, that airflow is used to cool the skins.
So the air comes in the bottom of the laptop.
Yep.
Traditionally. And then basically you're taking that air and channeling it in the usual exhaust routes, side and into the back. But then you're also taking that air and blowing it over the rest of the laptop.
Yep. So what we're doing is, so Alienware, most gaming systems today, if you look at our Alienware systems, we have dual outlet, but it's at a 90 degree angle. It pushes out the back corners of the system. This system's different. That fan, we can't grow the impeller large enough to take up 90% of the space due to frictional losses, due to the fin stack on both sides of that fan. What makes this unique is half of the fan is going to the fin stack. The other half is actually going to the internal system where the motherboard is. We are positively pressurizing the box. Gordon, do you remember something from Intel called hyperbaric technology?
Yes.
This is somewhat similar to that in that we're positively pressurizing the box and we're actually streaming airflow and channeling it over the hotspot, over the CPU, over the motherboard.
Yeah, that's so, I mean, when I sort of kind of finally got what this was, I sort of thought, well, this is a hyperbaric chamber. I've sort of seen this in other laptops, but so what's specifically the difference? Because I guess the hyperbaric chambers are fixed right along the fin stack for the cooler.
So the difference here is the fact that if you talk about hyperbaric per se, it's really positively pressurizing the chamber. The fin stack is positively pressurized, but in this case, we still have a negative region, which is on the intake side of the fan. So what we have to do is we gasket the fan to that bottom cover, right? So that's your negative region. So there's no recirculation. The key here really is the size of the impeller. That's what's unique. The reason we're getting more airflow than, say, the previous hyperbaric approach by Intel, they were still using traditional fans that were 60 to 70% of the housing space. We are going beyond 90%. And the relationship is basically the diameter. If you talk about airflow and pressure, it's a cubic relationship to the size of the diameter of the impeller. And it's a squared relationship between CFM and pressure head. So you get a very large gain based upon that overall design. So thermally, if you talk about what's the best is using all the surface area. So how do I get heat out of the box? Basically, I want to dump it into, say, a heat pipe or a vapor chamber, go to the fin stack. That air is going through the fin stack. That's path A. path B is really the motherboard out, right? So if I take airflow and I blow it over the board, I'm cooling that board directly with that airflow. I'm getting it out of the box. So from a physics perspective, the best thing I can do is cool the fin stack as well as cool the rest of the motherboard. That maximizes the surface area. It also maximizes the airflow. That's where we're going.
Okay. Which you have to do, you know, and I've seen a lot of vendors sort of say, you know, they do market on blades. They'll say we have more blades, you know, like, you know, five blade razor, we have metal blades and all that stuff. Does that matter? This is actually specifically different than just simply we added more blades to it.
Yep. So we've got one patent already granted. We've got six on this. So basically from my perspective, we own the technology and what's unique, right? So as I thin the blade, so if I had a, I'll just use a number, a 0.2 millimeter thick blade. If I can take that blade to 0.1, I get more blades on the impeller. So every rotation I get additional pressure head and negative pressure on the backside of the blade to pull air in. It's about a 3 to 5% gain. So if you went from 0.2 to 0.1, you'll get a 5% difference in PQ. The difference here was this is like 30%. This is depending on where you're at. Now there is a limitation, and this is where the system design is critical. You get much higher flow, but if you're at very high impedances, you can actually hurt your performance. So this is where the physics come into play. So if I have very high velocities, it's something. So I don't know if you've ever heard the term Bernoulli's equation.
Definitely not.
Okay. Pressure loss. So if you talk about airflow, like when we're designing these fans, usually what we have to do is we have to balance the frictional loss. So that air is blowing over a fin. It creates friction and you lose some of that airflow. So the trick is basically optimizing the design for the fan, just like your car. The engine is critical for your miles per gallon, your horsepower, your torque as you're driving down that road. If you want it to be really responsive, that's key. The fan is identical to that in a chassis. So it all starts with the engine, which is the fan itself. And what we've done, I mean, similar, if you take Ford's EcoBoost, right, putting a turbocharger on it, we increase the size of the impeller as large as we can within the space. You can't beat that, right? So if you talk about a fundamental physics, you can always go thinner blades, you could go metal blades, you can add more blades, but maximizing the impeller is where you get a key benefit.
And I just want to make sure it's clear to everybody, the impeller is the entire prop assembly or just simply the center section?
So it is just the fan. So if you look at the blades themselves, that's what we call an impeller. It has a shaft and then there's basically magnets and windings around it. And that's what rotates the impeller.
And is this simply just the shape of the blade? Because I mean, you know, typically on a desktop PC, it's unidirectional fans. This is, you're sort of choosing to go multi-direction with this in a way?
Yeah. So here's the difference. That impeller is critical because as you grow the blade, if you take that same blade and you put a traditional housing with one outlet, what happens is the frictional losses, that fan wants to push that high airflow. But what happens is and I'm going to use a number, right? Imagine a hurricane wind, right? You're outside, you feel that wind. That's what's going on inside that little housing. So as it blows around the housing, the pressure is so high that you actually lose performance. And so the key is we looked at that and said, okay, hey, that doesn't make sense. If we try to shove this large impeller, that's 90% of the enclosure housing, within that space, what do you have to do? You have to open up the secondary outlet. When you open up that secondary outlet, you cut the velocities in half. So instead of having a tornado wind, you have a nice breeze that you can manage the pressure losses. And so that's how we went in and optimized the design. So if you look at basically the XPS 17 or the Precision variant, basically for those systems themselves, you're going to see that we're getting much higher flows than anyone else in that same volume of space.
Yeah, and I think your own numbers say it's about 50% greater cooling in the XPS 17 versus the 15.
Yep.
Wow. And of course, that's because the 15 doesn't have the DOO fans.
Now there's a gap. So if you look at this, it is really important. There's some downsides to it. You have to manage impedance, and you have to manage that flow path. It must be gasketed. And so if you look at how we design the system, when you open it up, you will see that it's sealed to the D cover because you have that positive pressure. If there was any leakage, you get recirculation and that you immediately lose efficiency and performance.
Right. It's basically blowing wind everywhere instead of directionality.
Exactly. We want the airflow to go through the fin stack. We want the airflow to go over the motherboard out the system. That's the key.
And for people who aren't laptop nerds, the D cover is the bottom of the laptop. So that means the fan is on the bottom, and then essentially there's some kind of foam sealant to the bottom to seal it. And when you refer to impedance, can you explain that to me like I'm a regular person? Yeah.
So have you ever drove your car and stuck your hand out the window? Right. You see these kids that actually run their hand around. That pressure that you feel is the airflow pressure. That resistance is the same as like a system pushing on the fan. That is impedance. It's impeding airflow. So if you guys ever wanted to nerd out, you could go look at any fan. They'll give you a curve that shows you the performance at a given impedance or pressure. And so from Dell's perspective, we go optimize all these parameters. We will look at the DOO. We will look at a traditional evacuative fan. Then we look at our ID, our foot height, the venting, how much fin stack do I have? We add all of those pressures up and we optimize the design based upon the data. I know that's a quick crash course in how you design a PC, but every single system that we do, it's the same process. You want to optimize airflow and impedance.
And that's just the fan section, because there's a lot more. Hey, stick around. We are going to talk about everything in a laptop for cooling. So the important part we're talking about here is additional airflow inside that laptop, that super tight laptop. Dell uses something called, it's made by Gore. It's a Gore insulation. It's called Aerogel, I think.
Yep. So
what does that do exactly?
So fantastic question. With our XPS 13 products, we were on a mission for a long time. Gore came to the table with their expanded polytetrafluoroethylene. So all the Gore-Tex material, think about it. It's basically Teflon. You pull it real hard mechanically, you create all these voids. So all of their material is the same. What they do is aerogel material is the lowest thermal conductivity of any material. So it's really resistive to heat transfer. It's like a shield. If you look at it versus like fiberglass insulation in your walls, right? So if you guys have a home and you insulate your walls, this material is an order of magnitude lower in conductivity than the fiberglass insulation. Very, very resistive. The challenge is it's really, really brittle. So it's like glass. So if you feel the raw material, it crumbles. And so what we were able to do with Gore is Gore came to the table and said, we can solve this problem. Let's backfill our EPTFE sheet with the aerogel material. And so they take the EPTFE, they backfill it with aerogel, they dry it, and that's the sheet insulation.
So my question though is the aerogel, I was surprised, maybe I'm wrong because I only saw one picture, but on the Precision, the aerogel is on the bottom. I thought it would be on the top though to keep the keyboard cooler.
So it depends where the location is. Our specifications, which I can't go into it, are much more aggressive on the keyboard, palm rest, touchpad. Right? Okay. So that's common touch areas. Usually when we use that material is if we have a hot spot. So say the CPU is facing down or the heat pipe is facing down, or you have a power regulator, what's driving the CPU's power. Those get very hot. Typically what you may see is we'll take a sheet of insulation to shield the user's legs as an example. And what we're trying to do in that case is we're actually trying to drive the energy up into the heat pipe or the vapor chamber. We don't want it to go to your legs. So we want it to go out the heat pipe fin stack path to keep the user comfortable and cool.
Yeah, I sort of assumed that it was there to just keep our legs from burning, but you're also getting the dual purpose of driving that heat to the whatever the cooling device is.
So, I mean, if you had an ideal solution, right, I would insulate everything. I would try to drive everything into the heat pipe and the fin stack if that was fundamentally possible. You always will have heat transfer. Heat transfer literally is molecules vibrating, right? They're hitting each other, and that's how you transfer energy. It's literally going from a low temperature to a high temperature, flip that high temperature to low temperature. But it's basically electron transfer and bouncing of molecules. And so that type of fundamental physics is what we're trying to do. The insulation itself gives us the capability to shield. It's very resistive. The heat doesn't want to go that way. It hits this vapor wall and basically the aerogel. The material's fascinating. If any of your viewers want to review it, look up the Stardust probe. It is the exact same material they used in the Stardust probe where they took this satellite through the backside of the, I think it was the comet. They captured all the particles. The aerogel was used to actually look at the trace length of the particle capture, and they used that to determine how fast those particles were going. And then they could actually capture those particles. It is fascinating, but yeah, take a look at it. It is identical as far as material we used in the laptop.
So space age materials in your laptop, of course. Yep. So, okay. I now understand what it does and why I use it. The other thing I definitely want to ask about is graphite. I thought there's no way to have graphite on the roof. Sorry, that's a Chernobyl joke, but what is the graphite used for in these laptops? I thought that would be an insulator as well.
Now, great question. So the physics, right? We talked about airflow, we talked about insulators. The graphite is polar opposite to an insulator. It is extremely conductive. So if you talk about copper, so I don't know, your viewers will probably use a pot on a stove, right? So if you take a metal pot and put it on a stove, it heats up, you grab it. That's because it's conducting energy into your hand. Graphite or graphite sheets, Neograph is one of the main companies. Panasonic is another. The conductivities are multiples of copper. So if you look at some of the synthetic graphites that we use today, which are actually a mixture of graphene and graphite, they can go as high as between 1600 to 1800 watts per meter K. To put that in perspective, copper is about 300. So you're wow. Five times more conductive in one direction than copper. What's interesting about the material, because it's isotropic, basically it does, the through plane conductivity is really low. It's like two, but the in plane, so the way those molecules are shaped. So if you look at graphene structure, basically they're structured in plane. The energy really wants to go in plane, let's say left and right from this image. It right. doesn't want to go through. So here's what happens. If you put the graphene underneath the keyboard, here's what happens. The energy wants to go up. It hits the wall. It spreads out quickly. You distribute that energy over the entire surface. So a lot of times, if you take an IR image, an infrared camera image, if you ever seen the movie Predator, that's kind of yes. like the image, right? If you take an IR image, you can see that it's very uniformly heated. It's because of that material.
Huh. Yeah, that's very interesting, because it seems like most people think like, well, let's just insulate it using, obviously the aerogel would be great, but that's probably a little tough to use. But you're actually just spreading the heat out faster, so it just doesn't accumulate under the keyboard.
Yep. So the key is for us, we want to put as much energy into the box as we can to give you performance. So as you guys are doing your Zoom call, your Skype call, you're pushing those CPUs to the max. If you're gaming, say you're doing VR, where you're driving the physics and the GPU, really what you want to support as much power as you can in the smallest form factor. This is what we do extremely well. And what we try to do is say, okay, I want to take that energy. I purposefully want to basically put the energy up through the keyboard into the ambient to a point where the user's comfortable. I don't want to go beyond that because of user comfort, but I do want to use that as a heat rejection path. We can get you more performance by doing that. Now, there's a point, right? And basically, energy, if you said this is the CPU, say my fist is the CPU, energy can go up, down, left, and right, right? Just from it being hot. We put a heat pipe on it to drive the energy that direction. Energy is still going up through the keyboard. It is still going down through the bottom. So our goal is to, within Dell specs, keep it within the creature comfort limit in both conditions while maximizing the power.
Right. And I guess if you were to insulate it, so the heat's going up, if you were to just say, let's just wall off the keyboard with, 3 inches of aluminum, it's still a problem because you want the heat to conduct up. It's, you sort of hurt your thermal conductivity by suddenly having hit this wall then, I guess?
Yep. So here's the balance, right? It's just like you're in your shower. You've gotten the hot and cold knobs. If I put too much aerogel insulation, I'm turning that hot knob all the way up. You can have a TJ problem, your component temperature limit, because I don't have enough cooling, total cooling capacity. If I have all graphite, I'm potentially putting the cold button all the way up, and all that energy is going into the keyboard or the D cover. The trick or the optimization is you want to balance those two knobs to make sure that you're hitting your spec on the strip keyboard area, which is that C cover where the keyboard is, the D cover, then maximizing power to get out of the box through the fin stack. If you can do that, you have optimized the design. And here's some cases what happens. A lot of times, if we have large components, we may have to push that motherboard down next to the bottom cover. The D cover could get hot. We may purposefully add insulation to shield the user to drive the energy up because we have such a large air gap on the top side of the board. So it's all about optimizations. We talked about it with the DOO fan. We optimized, right? We went in, we looked at the physics and said, grow the impeller, right? reduce friction drops, frictional losses by giving it two airflow paths, right? Now, if you look at the aerogel insulation, we did the same thing. I said, okay, for the case where we have these large air gaps, let's insulate the user. And then if you look at the keyboard, we may decide that, okay, let's spread. So we have all these tools in the toolkit that gives us the capability to optimize depending on what the design requirements require. But all of this is from physics.
Yeah, you know, it's funny because I think most people, you take the back of a laptop off, they all kind of look the same. You're not understanding the physics. I suspect, you know, those little everything from the aerogel to the graphite, and even possibly the shape, and I guess maybe even the thickness. Well, then you have to balance it with the thickness of the actual, you know, bottom of it, right? Whatever that material is, huh? Because unfortunately in most industries, you know, people say optimize. It doesn't really mean anything to anybody anymore because everybody does optimize. But I think it's great to know, like, wow, there really is optimization. Like what you're talking about here is like, oh, you actually did your homework. Just kind of like, not just write optimize in the marketing material.
Yeah, we're a different animal, right? So if you look at what we have to do, we do like tenths of millimeters. So if you look at our foot height and you go to Dell product, you're going to have one that's 1.4 millimeters, say on an XPS product. And if you go to Precision, it's like 3.3 or whatever the delta is. We go in and we optimize those foot heights in simulation until we have it spot on. This is the optimal point for pressure drop underneath the system. So as that airflow comes under that system through the foot and into the vent for our ID, the ports, all the limitations, all of that is done to that level of analysis. We do this all in all this simulation 2 years in advance. So if you look at the products we work on, we have no hardware at the time. All this work is done very early.